In the dark, dark tomb, there was a dark, dark street. And in the dark, dark street, there was a dark, dark office. In the dark, dark office, there were some dark, dark stairs. And down the dark, dark stairs, there was a dark, dark room. And in the dark, dark room is where the worst wrestling tropes go to die.
Hello, I'm Ross from Cultaholic.com and welcome to Straight to Hell, the show where my illustrious guest offers up a list of pet peeves from the world of professional wrestling. Then I get to decide which one of those things goes straight to hell to rest in damnation for all of eternity. Joining me today is a man who I met in a galaxy far, far away, a man who can wrestle and a man who can sing and a man who very recently made me think to myself, I've got to watch what I say here because he's calling out UFC champions. Joining me today is Joe Hendry. How are you, Joe?
I'm very well, thanks. Thanks for having me. It's weird to be sitting here in a studio.
I've got to ask.
And talking to yourself. It's been a while.
It has been a while. On a scale of 1 to 10, how prestigious is this room?
Oh no, this is a studio, by the way. Very prestigious. I give it a 9.5 because nothing gets
strong.
A 10. Nothing gets a 10.
Not even your own bedroom.
10's perfect. Well, come on now. You're getting personal now. You're upsetting me already. But no, 9.5 because 10's unattainable. For the most part.
So let's explain how this shindig will go down. Joe will offer 5 things that he wants to see go straight to hell. We'll have a bit of back and forth. We'll laugh. We might even cry. Then I'll get to live out a childhood fantasy by hitting that big red button, not starting a nuclear war, and sending something from the world of professional wrestling straight to hell. This is nothing like BBC's Room 101. So let's get cracking with the knacking. Joe Hendry, your first suggestion that goes straight to hell, please.
Okay, this is weird for me. I'm usually pretty quiet about my thoughts of the inner workings of pro wrestling, but this is dangerous. This could be dangerous. But
in what way?
Well, just I think I try to. I think it's better to, sometimes it's better to, be open and let your feelings out. Sometimes it's better just to internalize it and keep it down inside. And I usually thought pet peeves about the wrestling business would be one of those, but, why not? I've never done it before, so here we are. The first one is a chant in particular that annoys me. Don't get me wrong, there's a few wrestling chants that make me go, ah! But this one in particular really gets me. Wrestling!
Right.
Okay.
When you're watching wrestling, can you hear
someone
shout wrestling?
Yeah, and someone goes, wrestling! Now, can you imagine, Ross, if you went to the football and everyone's chanting for their particular teams and someone just stands up and goes, football!
They would be escorted out after the season ticket torn up and never be allowed back.
Exactly. They would be taken out either by the staff or by, ambulance crew.
Or if you're watching Newcastle, Jamal Lascelles will hop over the barricade and escort them out himself.
Exactly. That chant to me is, it's kind of a, I said that, I'm funny. And that's just like, no, yes, you are here to see wrestling. We are aware. Thank you for reminding us. And now let's resume with the show. Maybe that's a little bit. It's not the only one that gets on my nerves.
Obviously, we could do an own show. We chant straight to
hell. We could. The one that gets me as well. Now, let's be clear. The wrestling one is if we're going to pick one here, it's got to be that. But also, Fight Forever kind of ticks me off as well. Because I get, okay, carry on.
Sorry,
carry
after on. You're
interrupting the prestigious one.
Oh, it started.
I know. So again, you're at the football, Ross. And you want your team to win so badly, and someone goes, play forever, play forever. No, play within the finite time that you've been allocated and try to win.
But what if a match hasn't been given a time limit?
Well, no, that's fine. I'm talking about football, Ross. How many
matches? I'm for the wrestling.
No,
version.
Well, I'm on football now. Right. So how many matches of football that you've seen didn't have a finite time?
I don't think I've ever seen one.
Yeah, you haven't seen that. Now we can go back to wrestling.
Right, so now, what if that match hasn't been given a time limit?
But why would you want it to go on forever?
You're sad. You have no life. You've got nowhere to go after the show.
Well, fair enough. I can't argue with that. I can't personally empathise with that. But I guess that happens.
I get it's an overused chat now, I think, as I well. Think, it's one of those that started off organically with Kevin and Sammy.
I think that's what it is. I think the thing is, it's like I miss... kind of having a favourite and wanting that favourite to win. I miss goodies and baddies. I miss that kind of, sometimes I think we can overthink wrestling. And I like it when it's, it's that saying, what are we doing here? We're telling stories. And it's like, personally, for me, I like to see a conclusion, you know, and that one for me, I don't want to forget the fact that it's a contest and there should be consequences to winning and losing. So that's one of mine, but the wrestling one is the one that they get.
But just going back to the fight forever.
Okay.
If I had to push you for a replacement, if you were Joe Hendry, the fan in the arena, what would you do instead of that chant?
Instead of that chant? Oh.
What would you stand up and clap your hands and do in the middle of the arena?
Let's go, insert name.
Right.
Not let's go, insert name. You know, don't, for God's sakes, don't start that. For God's sakes. It's hard for, hey, I'm a wrestler. I leave that stuff to me. You know, I'll leave the chance to the fans and I'll intervene and take ones away where necessary.
Okay.
So I'm going to take away Fight Forever. I'm going to take away wrestling. You know, not wrestling as a whole. Let's not take that clip out of context. I'm going to take away that chant. And, you know, when it's time, it's had a bit of wrestling, maybe give you it back. And if you use it more responsibly, then maybe you can keep it. But just not all the time.
I mean, I wholeheartedly agree with you on the wrestling chant. Another one that's similar, which gets me, is this is wrestling. This is wrestling. Boom, 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 boom. There's a ring there. There's an entranceway there. Of course it is. What else could it be?
That's true. I mean, the we are awesome one.
I mean, that's just like admitting you're a grade A arsehole. Yeah. Grade A arsehole.
We are awesome. Wow. Are you? Maybe you are. I don't know.
You're
there to see a wrestling
show.
That's
for other people to judge, isn't it?
Yeah.
Not for this guy himself.
Yeah, I think there's that thing of it's like, I like it when fans are there to see the show and enjoy what's in front of them, rather than like, I started that chant, by the way, you know?
The gay camp. Oh, I was about to do a Scottish accent there. Jesus.
Go for it, try it.
The guy behind me can't see. That sort of guy as well. He would be at that show with that sound as well.
Yeah.
But since I...
So your Scottish impression was changing the word guy to gay.
Was it? Not intentionally, but if it came out that way, I wholeheartedly apologise. But I'm just saying that the same guy who would chant wrestling, this is wrestling, would have the guy behind me can't see on a sign as well. But since I wholeheartedly agree, Joe Hendry, we're kicking things off with a bang because the chant wrestling...
Oh my God,
dude,
have you got health and safety for that thing going on behind
you? We probably should, shouldn't we?
You should. You didn't warn me about that.
So we are one for one so far. Joe Hendry, your second nomination for Straight to Hell, please.
Dives.
Right, .. dives, or all dives.
Okay, here's the thing. Again, you know what I was saying with the chance? Sometimes the prestigious one has to step in and just, you know, take something away for a little bit. Dives is going to have to be one of those things. The dives .. is probably a bad example because, you know, that's the Ospreys t-shirt, isn't it? That one.
It was the exchange on Twitter, wasn't it, with Randy Orton?
Well, and the thing is, to me, like, having wrestled Ospreay, like, I have seen firsthand his talent in particular is, you know, upper echelon. Like, it's next level. The things that guy can do are unbelievable. But so I'm not talking about him specifically because, you know, to me, he is the master of that style. But when I say dives, what I mean is it's because they're so overused now, they don't mean what they used to. You know, so it's like when you saw Stan Hansen dive through the bottom and middle rope, it was like, oh my God, it was a huge thing. And I think that's the thing in wrestling. It's just like when one thing starts to get some traction, I feel everybody does it. And I think from seeing it from a wrestler's point of view, like people tend to rely on stuff like that too much. Because the truth is, if you do dive out of the ring, it's going to get, you know, a big reaction. Now, that is a skill, but it's a different skill to being what we would consider a worker, you know? So it's kind of, I think it's almost like dives should, like, if they're going to be used, it should be used, like, when you've already kind of learned the basics. I think you see a lot of this now where people are trying to run before they can walk, that sort of thing. But also in matches, there is a dive in... Is it fair to say there's a dive in most matches?
Not just about every match, yeah.
Just about every
match.
No matter
the size of the wrestler as well, which is the...
And now we know from seeing that a thousand times, like, how many times have you seen a match end because of a dive?
Not many. It's normally the dive happens, thrown back in, and then the...
Yeah, I'm throwing out a challenge to a wrestler out there. try and finish a match with a dive. Try and do a dive that's so devastating that when you throw your opponent back in the ring, you pin them, one, two, three, and it's done. But then again, that'll probably, you know...
kill somebody. What would that look like?
I don't know. Probably me, my big ass diving over the top would probably that someone. But to be fair, I have done it myself. I've done it three times.
Torpe suicida?
No, it was...
Congelo?
It was... I would describe it as falling through the middle and top rope.
Buzz Lightyear falling with style.
Yeah, there's something in... there's something in my brain that just can't do it. So I've done it three times in big feuds. So I did it, the first one was against Killian Dane, which was my first, you know, big feud in ICW. I did that one. The next time I did, and that was like a kind of hardcore match. The next time I did it was against Drew McIntyre, and that was the first time I wrestled him. That was in Belfast. And then the only other time I did it was against Will Ospreay. And again, it was, I'm trying to think of an analogy for something that is not graceful.
A bus?
Yeah, it was a bus trying to squeeze through the middle and top rope and falling onto Will Ospreay. Yeah. Because what I do is I'll charge off with all the might in the world. And then if you watch it in slow motion, what I do is I charge off and I come back, stop, and then go. You know what I mean? So yeah, I'm a hypocrite here. I've done it myself three times, so...
We're all hypocrites, don't worry about it.
If you press that button, I could be incinerated here. But yeah, I think, to be honest with you, it's not to say that they shouldn't happen, because there's definitely a place for them. It's just I feel now it's so overused to the point where it becomes expected, so every time the reaction is just a little bit less and a little bit less. So when you press the button, let's say if this is hell, you know, maybe I'm making the decision for you. I don't know, maybe you need a purgatory button. Because I feel that dives should maybe be in purgatory. But if you know, you've only got one button, you know,
I mean,
if it's
who
up
knows?
To me.
We might get to the point where things start to fight their way back out of hell.
Exactly. Okay. Well, then in that case, I could put dives
just
in
like
hell.
The wrestling business, yeah. This show might evolve to that, because that's what it is. It's the evolution of the business where the big man can do what the little man can do. Therefore, what the little man does isn't necessarily standing out from what the big man can do. So, like Luke Harper is the example I look at in WWE. He flies through there like Rey Mysterio used to back in 1997. It's incredible to see. Correct me if I'm wrong, but do wrestling promotions not have a bit of paper on the wall that says, this man does this move, this man does that move, so you don't use the same moves in the same match all the way down the card? Because that would be a sensible thing to do to me as a man who's not in the business, so to speak.
Well, but at the end of the day, Ross, professional wrestling is a contest that as a professional wrestler, you're trying to win.
Yeah.
So... it's as simple as that, Ross. But it would be ideal if everybody wasn't using everybody else's moves.
I'm painting myself to be a traditionalist here, which I'm not, if you hadn't guessed. But isn't that not the traditional thing you do? Like, you build up the card to more wow stuff at the top, and like you make sure nothing's repeated and
well,
stuff
actually,
like that.
Actually, this leads rather nicely into my next point, which we'll cover in, you know, I'm sure we'll get there.
So you're pushing me for a decision now.
I'm pushing you for a decision.
I think they are overused. I'd just like to clarify, for my integrity's sake, I'm not threatened by Joe Hendry here today. He's being nice to me. I'm not feeling pressured or bullied into putting these things straight into hell, because we are now 2-for-2. Dives. Ah!
Oh my goodness! And that's technically me in there as well. So
if you want to put him in there, Sam, go for
it.
Yeah,
I've done it three times, so, you know.
Joe Hendry straight to hell, in hell himself. It's a first. And as seamless can be, we are on to Joe Hendry's third point. What is it?
Well, first of all, I just want to bring something up. You're saying this whole thing about you're not threatened by me, I'm being nice to you. If you recall, the time when I picked you up for the freak of nature...
That was somebody else.
You did something to me first. Did you not, like, poke my ear or put your finger in my ear or something?
Whoever
like that
was dressed in the cape, yeah, and crown, they might have given you a wet willy.
Yeah, you look a lot like him.
That's my brother.
Now, what self-respected wrestler is going to let you give them a wet willy and not do anything about it?
I mean, I don't know if I can answer that.
Were you
that.
Trying to ruin my career?
No,
you were
absolutely
trying to ruin
not.
My career.
We'll
just so I picked you up for the freak of nature. I'll tell you what your main ability was. I don't know how, but every time I'd pick you up for the freak of nature, your entire arse would fall out.
I mean, it's certain people have certain gifts, don't they? Mine was a particularly
If I paid you up for it right now,
don't
I guarantee your arse would be falling out all over the
ill.
Room.
I'm ill. Don't touch us. But yeah, I've heard from that guy it was just banter. That's all
right,
it was.
Okay, okay.
The dark and evil forces of Richard Keys took over us that day. Anyway, your third pick.
Oh, third pick is...
Just get, get my arse out of your head.
I'm emotional now. Leave the memories alone. Third thing would be, again, I understand why it was there, but I'm going to have to come in and take it away for a bit. The match rating system. The star rating system. Yeah. And the reason is because I think what the star rating system represents is, I get it, it's about this kind of, it only really aligns itself to me with that sort of main event style. But not every match should be the main event. Like, to me, if you had a true star rating system, it would be, how well did this match convey this particular story? Like, to me, what star rating would they give to Goldberg versus Lesnar when he first came, when he came back
the 1 minute 20 seconds.
Exactly, exactly. Now, if we were to look at that in like the kind of the way that it's rated now, in terms of what people would call a 5-star match, but to me, everyone was talking about that match. Yeah. And again, it was the fact that they managed to do that with, you know, less than 2 minutes time, to me, does that not put it right up there in the star rating system? It does in my mind, but that's not the way that people think about the star rating system. And to me, if you had a card top to bottom of hour-long epic battles that are back and forth, it just wouldn't be what, you know, just maybe my opinion, what professional wrestling should be. Yeah, there should be, you know, at the top of the card, perhaps one or two of the matches that fall within that rating system. But I think I worry that fans are now conditioned to expect that from every single match. And to me, it's if the story is conveyed perfectly, then it's a 5-star match in my mind.
I can certainly see what you mean. The way I look at star ratings is like, if you've missed an event, you can just check, like, it's like TV guys.
It's a fair point.
Do I check out that match, or do I just give it a miss? I trust this guy's opinion.
Yeah.
Do I see it or do I not? You've put me in a tough position, Joe Hendry, because as a man who sits here in this very studio and reviews wrestling and gives his opinions on wrestling, me shutting down another form of opinionated wrestling coverage would be slightly hypocritical of me. Do you not think?
Maybe it would be. Maybe it would be, but it's the good of wrestling that we're talking about. I think for me, it's just like, I don't think it's the star rate, like the idea of giving something, you know, 5 stars, 4 stars, whatever, you know, because that's how movies are done. But I think it's more just like the structure that people expect of what a 5-star match is. Whereas I've given you an example, and you know, I'm sure we can go through a few more of matches that would not fall in within that sort of expected structure that to me convey what was supposed to be conveyed absolutely perfectly. I think that's the issue of what people think is 5 stars.
I see they watch the show one way in terms of seeing the story develop, then they review the show in a different way, like looking at it objectively. Did I think that match was good or not?
Yeah, and
without
I think
taking the story into account.
And it puts wrestlers in a difficult position because, like, I'll give an example. When I was, I mean, you'll remember when I was, you know, champion somewhere else.
Name redacted pro wrestler. Name redacted pro wrestler.
Yes.
Know it very well.
No, when I was WCPW champion, now known as Defiant. Relax. we're being factual here. When I was the champion there, I could have. If I'm wrestling somebody, and that was, you remember, I wouldn't talk to fans. Literally £100 if you want a photo with me. I treated the fans terribly. But I did that because I felt that was the right thing to do for where we were going with it, and also that I felt like I was contributing to the wrestling business because I thought no one's really doing that right now. So I've got a choice in the ring. Am I going to do a springboard enziguri, or am I going to poke the guy in the eyes? You know, and one of them's going to get a particular star rating and one of them's not. So it's like,
you're not there to please the crowd in your role as the heel, are you?
But the thing is, see, when you go down that road of going, no, this is what's right for the story, it doesn't lend itself well to online opinion, to merchandise sales. It really makes being the bad guy a really thankless job. You know, it makes it very difficult. And I think because, so I guess it's maybe not the 5-star rating in itself, it's just that kind of expectation of what wrestling is and what wrestling should be, I think makes it difficult for people who do want to go down a kind of story-based
traditional
approach, you know? Or that's maybe just me saying, you know, I don't want to dive off the top rope, thanks. You know, who knows?
I mean, you proved you can. I'm not going to sit here and say you can't.
My body went through the middle and top rope. That did happen. It wasn't graceful, but it did happen.
That means there's more impact.
That's true. No. But the point is, when I went out, every time my feet get caught on the bottom rope, so it's like, and then, so it's just kind of a, you know.
I see you. But as the star ratings go, I can't do it. I can't sit here as a man who reviews wrestling and take someone else's way of reviewing wrestling and send it straight to hell.
Why? You slag
everything
else.
That's my community.
You slag everything else off. You want to slag off your own community?
No. We've got to stick strong us.
You just don't want to admit I've gone 3 for 3.
I mean, there's a part of that wants me integrity to stay intact. But no, I can't. I don't want to be a hypocrite. I'm a hypocrite enough in my life. There's just one bit here. I'm going to stay clear, keep my conscience clear, and move on with my life. So the star ratings as a concept stays out of Straight to Hell. Or doesn't go straight to hell. It stays out of hell. We're over halfway there now. Joe Hendry, your fourth pick, please.
Try to think of the best way to phrase this, but it comes down to not protecting the business.
Oh, this sounds heavy, so I'm just going to take a step back and let you have a little rant.
It's pretty heavy. It's to be honest with you, I maybe I'm old school, but I just kind of miss that mentality. There should be something should be protected. You know, nowadays it's like there are certain things that are going on, and the fans know more than I do. And I'm like, how is this happening? You know, and it's I feel that there are just some things that the fans shouldn't know, and I don't mean that in a bad way. And that like I don't want them knowing that. I mean like I enjoy things more when I don't know everything that's going on. Like, for example, I watched Darren Brown's special the other night. I don't want to know every intricate detail. I want him to keep some of that because it allows me to think about it. It allows me to go away and really process what I've seen. If you give someone all the answers, it's just it doesn't have that same intrigue, and it's just not as special anymore. There's something about that intrigue, and that comes from, you know, many different angles. But also, there is this discussion right now about like kind of, oh, you know, wrestling's an art form, and just because you don't like that particular part of it, blah blah. I take that to an extent, but I'll tell you what, don't want to see any invisible grenades, don't want to see any slow motion, and people go, oh, that's but it's an art form. Yeah, an art form you're now no longer allowed to partake in because of your nonsense. The other day I saw a clip of a guy hold his opponent's hand, run up the ropes, and badly sing an entire verse in chorus. Oh, it was a Backstreet Boys or NSYNC, you know, whatever. Fantastic
I'm a
band.
Yeah.
No. his opponent just stood there and let him walk around, you know, nearly falling off the thing, and then come down and, you know, boom. And there we go. And it's just like, yeah, that's funny for 2 seconds, but it really takes you out of the moment. You know, it breaks that. Like, if I'm watching a movie, I don't want you know, the final scene of Breaking Bad to be building up, and then I'm to turn around and go, ah, only joking. you know what I mean? It's like, I don't want things that are gonna, the whole point. And what I realized the other day is, it's like, when I was having a really stressful time the other week, a lot going on in my life right now, and I was like, you know what, I'm gonna go back and watch some of my favorite matches, not for research purposes, not for any of that, but because I'm feeling the stress today, and I kind of want to unwind, and I had a blast, and my problems just went out the window. And that's, to me, I was like, that's what wrestling is. That's why people love wrestling, because basically it's there for us when we need, you know, just a little bit of something to face the stresses and the problems. It gives us that escape. So when I have someone basically just taking me out of that moment, it's frustrating. And to me personally, just my opinions, and that's the thing about wrestling, everybody has lots of different opinions. And to me, I like it to, if we look at wrestling as a universe where it's like certain rules apply, you can bend those rules, but don't break them.
So am I right in saying this is a multi-layered thing? It's, in terms of the fans, in terms of the certain new moves you see that you wouldn't have seen 25, 30 years ago?
To be honest, if something makes sense, like in terms of moves, like if something makes sense, I don't have a problem with it. But it's like if someone goes like, throws it in the middle of the ring, and they all go, get out of the ring and never come back. You know, it's just like to me, that's just, it's not for me. And again, that's just my opinion. I know some people might like that, but to me, it's just, it's that's a hard one to justify that one. That's my inner cornet talking there. He's there.
I mean, in terms of us fans, I'm a fan, using certain terminology from wrestling that we don't have any right to use because we're not in the wrestling business. Like, when I see people just throwing the word kayfabe in there, kayfabe it, pal, kayfabe it, don't tell
me. Because of the whole, like, Commonwealth UFC call-out thing, I had an Australian journalist called me, who's like a super nice guy, and he's really into wrestling and stuff like that. And he used the K word, and I was like, anytime that journalists do that, I just go, "What does that mean?"
And what do they say?
It makes people really uncomfortable. but yeah, I'm just, to me, like, look, everybody uses that word, everybody knows what that means, but I still have a principle that I'm not going to discuss it. And what I will say to the fans is, it's like, a lot of the time, there are certain, so there's the basics, you know, there's the K word, there's the M word, you know, you put the S in front of the M word, those things. But there are other ones, that's fine. That's your, you know, bonjour, C, right? If you take it to the next level, that's literally like, when people try and say things that are maybe like one or two levels above the basics to a wrestler, it's literally like me learning, you know, third year French and going around and going, bonjour. And it's just like, I know, it means hello.
In terms of wanting to peel the curtain back on the business, my interest goes as far as the backstage stuff, the stories, like, he doesn't like her.
Absolutely.
This happens.
Absolutely. And
I think that's fine to know.
And the truth is, 9 times out of 10, what's going on backstage is always more interesting than what's going on in the middle of the ring. I can testify to that.
Human nature, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And if you think about it, like, as wrestlers, we're egomaniacs. We need attention all the time. We're drama queens. You know what I mean? It's like, we didn't get into professional wrestling because we're stable people. You know what I mean? I like to think I've sorted myself out. But like I say, with wrestling, it's myself included, it's a lot of damaged people in some sort of way. It's a group of misfits that come together. So when that happens, it's going to be drama and explosions. And that side of things, you know, that, I'm not going to lie to you, that is the more entertaining stuff. But so it's not so much that, it's more the kind of industry terms.
I think that's fine, but on the other side of it, with the moves and how stuff works, I still find joy in seeing a move and thinking, how the hell did that not, like, literally kill them? And I don't want to know how they made it work.
Yeah, dude, even myself watching some stuff, I'm like...
Yeah, you just think, why did you do that? Well, how do you...
Yeah.
Yeah. So just in terms of the layers of this point, what are we sending to hell here? We're sending the fans knowledge.
But it's as much on us as wrestlers, you know what I mean? Like, divulging absolutely everything. It's really just, it's a lack of... It's just, I can't put it into a term.
It's the evolution of life, isn't it? And the access to information, which is literally a click away.
But again, it's
inevitable.
How do people
it?
Get that information? Fans are always going to, you know, want to get that information. But again, it's like the Derren Brown thing. It's like, I want to know how he did it, but the answer will never be as intriguing
with him
as
alone.
The thought process that goes into trying to figure it out. That's what I'm saying. So it's... I'm struggling here, man. My brain... I know what I'm trying to say, but I don't think we can, you know, for the purposes of your show...
It's a very deep subject.
It is a very deep subject.
And to generalize it in one little ball is much impossible.
In one ball, it is. I'm gonna let you try, and I'll give you. I'm gonna put the onus on you. I'm gonna let go of my responsibility as a guest here, be unprofessional, and I'm gonna pass it on to you. And I'll give you a thumbs up or a thumbs down.
So it's the sort of the fans using terminology, having knowledge.
It's terrible. Terrible.
I wasn't finished.
All right. Okay.
Having sort of access to things they shouldn't have access to. And acting as if they know more than you, a man who is in the ring.
What I want you to do, whoever's editing this, what I want you to do is, I want you to take what Ross just said word for word and put it up as like a graphic, like that whole entire paragraph. And that's it, yeah.
Right.
So, yeah.
So is it actually?
That. For the purposes of...
Oh, I did all right, didn't I?
But you did all right.
In terms of like modern moves as well, that just completely take you out of the competition aspect of wrestling.
Yeah.
Which I completely agree with as well.
Put that in brackets at the end as well.
So that's the two main things we're sending straight to hell here.
Yeah, in one sort of paragraph.
Do you want to do this together? Do you want to touch the button? I've never let anyone touch the button before. Tough, too late. Straight to hell, whatever that caption says, it's gone.
Oh my God. How can you... Can a paragraph that size fit in hell? I don't think it can.
In the words of Take That, I can't quite remember what the lyric is. We've come a long way and we've seen some things. Joe Hendry, your
that
fifth
sounds like
point.
That's a hit song right there. We've come a long way and we've seen some things.
Gary Barlow's best work.
All right, it is actually a song.
No, no, it, I mean, the first part of that lyric was correct.
We've come a long way, and we've seen some things.
And I'm a do-do-do-do.
Is, and I've seen some things.
Now it is.
Actually part of the song, okay, yeah. And we've seen the new hit single from the prestigious one, Joe Hendry, and name retracted Ross. We've seen some things.
Well done for using that. We could have been there sued go. There if you weren't
could,
careful.
Could have been sued.
Anyway, your well, fifth pick.
Yeah. fifth pick. Again, this is another one that's hard to put into words. But one thing that's kind of more of a... I'm just thinking, let's just take a step back a second. And it's like almost like gratitude. I'm tired of wrestlers being grateful for things. Like, so... Let me explain this one, because I'm a bit of a hypocrite here, because I'm extremely grateful for my fans and all that, and, you know, I talk about that quite a lot, and that's one thing. But one thing, so again, bit of a hypocrite, as wrestlers we usually always are, but one thing I notice is you'll get huge stars will say, like, I just can't believe I've got an action figure. I just can't believe it. And it's like, you should believe it. You're a huge star, you know? And I just think, like, could I imagine, like, The Rock saying, like, just...
I've heard he was the worst.
I just can't imagine...
He wet himself.
I just can't imagine The Rock going, seen myself in Toys R Us on Saturday, and I just couldn't believe it, you know?
As a wrestler, did you not have, like, when you first started out, a bucket list of things, like... The figures, the games, appearing on certain shows.
Oh, 100%, 100%.
So is that gone now?
No, but I'll keep it... And again, this is this thing. We can't express our feelings all the time.
Right.
We have to internalize them. It's very dangerous to speak your mind. You must keep it in here at all times. We're damaged people.
So I'm going to set the scene. You've gone to Jax or whoever makes, or Hasbro, whoever makes the figures these days. They've gone, Mr. Hendry, here are you. Here are you. Here is you in figure form. What would you do? Just slap out the hands. I don't want this. What would happen in that situation?
So, when I was presented with my first action figure, would I slap it out of someone's hand and say,
how dare
I don't
you
want
make
this?
That?
It sounds like you should be my manager, because that sounds like that would be a good career move. No, I would be, you know, when I get my first action figure, it will be absolutely unbelievable. But I'm going to, you know, go play it cool. You know, guys, check it out.
Play the long game.
I tell you what, I know what's going to happen. When it does finally happen, I'm going to piss myself and tears are going to be running down my eyes. I'm going to be like, and then someone will remind me that I said this and I forgot all about it. Again, I'm a giant hypocrite. I put things in hell and then I end up in hell with them, you know? Well, you put things in hell.
I'll put things in hell.
Yeah, you put things in hell. I'll give you that. But yeah, don't listen to me. I'm a massive hypocrite. We all are.
I mean, I've been exposed to this in my roles at previous companies where you get something that's been brought on by your creation, by your character and stuff. And I had that little, like, ooh, that's nice, isn't it?
It's that's different, though. You're not about to... I'm trying to think of the best way to put this without getting myself in trouble here. But it's different, Ross, isn't it?
How so,
it's,
Joe?
It's
I'm going to keep pushing you. How is it different?
Because...
I'm a YouTube celebrity.
Well, you're on YouTube, aren't you?
Part of Cultaholic.com. The fastest
true, hey.
Rising YouTube channel in
absolutely,
Newcastle.
Absolutely, absolutely. You're a part of that, yeah.
But I have... Yeah.
That sounded really... I didn't mean that to come across that way.
You did.
But I meant it to insult you, not Cultaholic. I just want to make that clear. It's almost like when... What Cultaholic should do is when... It's kind of like you're a minus draw. Do you know what I mean? So if they know they're going to sell like 200 tickets for something, they're like, if Ross is there, it's going to be 180, you know?
So why would you invite me on your show?
Well, I was going to talk to you about that.
Right.
I was going to talk to you about that. I was going to say what we might do is just kind of fade you out on the poster a little bit and put someone else
just Jack
there.
The Jobber.
Well, I'm hearing rumblings that even he might... We
might as well address this on camera.
Yeah.
He's backed out.
He has. But, you know,
the
again,
floor is yours to
if,
say something
if
about.
We're going to assess the input that Jack the Jobber was going to have, I mean, he could probably hear me. I think what we'll do is we'll get a cardboard cutout, and I think we'll have a speech bubble attached to the cardboard cutout, and it will say, generic whining. And I think what we'll do is we'll put that there on stage for a bit so people can see it and put it up on social media. And I think they'll probably pick sales up a bit when they know he's...
So if you want to come and see that cardboard cutout, where and when will it happen?
Exactly. Come and see that cardboard cutout live May 26th at the Clooney 2. Tickets at hendryshop.com. And you better be there.
I'll be there. Don't you worry. I'm the draw that night.
I'm
bringing in the house, brother.
Dude, thanks for the house. Thank you for the house. Hey,
no problem.
I'll give you that. I would be worried if you were dropping out. I'd be worried.
But back to wrestling figures and wrestlers receiving wrestling figures. I can't do it. I can't put it in the hell.
No, you're right.
That joy of, like, I've worked hard. I've got to this certain stage and a company's found my character worthy of making it into plastic form. That's something special. That's a beautiful thing.
It is. I regret saying it already.
You do?
I do. I regret saying it.
So that's not going into hell.
No. And you know what? I'm going to cry like a baby when I get my first action figure. I don't even
know. I hope we're there to film it.
Yeah, you know what?
Just put it side by side with this.
When it happens, I will, because I can make myself cry on demand. Do you know that?
Do you want to do it now?
Are you challenging me to cry on demand right now?
If you want to just shed a little tear and then do the tear in my eye promo, Ric Flair. Go on.
Don't make me laugh. It's harder when you make me laugh.
I can see the moisture forming.
It's there. And I only had to think about one thing.
Wow, it dropped down on the shirt. Go on, say with a tear in my eye like Ric Flair.
I just can't believe Jack pulled out. I don't know what I'll do.
Can we take five? And so with a tear in his eye, that is the end of the second ever episode of Straight to Hell. Things going to hell. Outweigh those.
Actually, wait, hang on a second. I've got one more thing to add here. All right? Now, a few weeks ago, I found out when I qualified for the Commonwealth Games that the UFC middleweight champion decided they wanted to play Commonwealth Games, put himself into freestyle wrestling in my weight class. So, being the upstanding citizen that I am, of course, I called him out. And he has not responded. Robert, I can't sell out this stadium by myself. You know what? I will. You don't need to say anything. I'll sell it all out for myself. All the Commonwealth tickets sold, no problem. But I'm putting him to hell for not getting back to me, damn it. He's UFC champ.
Just want to say his full name and address, just to
Robert
make sure he
Whittaker,
gets back.
Get back to me. We've got a stadium to fill here. Hendry versus Whittaker. Come on.
Fans, get on his side. Make sure Robert replies.
So, being the marketing genius that I am, I've prepared a handy hashtag for everyone to use. And it is hashtag Robert Whittaker, could you please check your Twitter mentions, because we have a fight to promote here and I could do with your help. So please get back to me in a timely fashion and we can continue as we go towards the fight taking place at the Commonwealth Games in the Gold Coast of Australia 2018.
I reckon that was just under...
It's two characters
the
left
character.
Over.
Is it right?
It's two characters left over, yeah.
So then, do you want to plug anything?
Absolutely. You know me, always.
The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. What I do want to say is thank you to everyone who has kind of supported me with the Commonwealth stuff. You know, it's tough being a self-funded athlete, but huge thanks to yourself and the Cultaholic team who are helping me out by coming along to the show that we're putting on May 26th. The Cultaholic gang are going to be there, including a cardboard cutout of Jack the Jobber as well. So please do come down. We're going to have a laugh. We're going to have some music. We're going to have musical renditions of my entrances and a live Q&A. Also, follow me on twitch.tv/Joe Hendry. That's where I'm spending most of my time these days. So please do follow me there. Twitter at Joe S. Hendry. Instagram at Joe Hendry Official. That was ridiculously long. I apologise.
Not at all. Joe Hendry.
Don't cut that.
This has been a delight. I'm trying to shake your hand, make it nice and civil. How times have changed from the fighting and whatnot. It's been lovely. I've been Ross from Cultaholic.com. Make sure you follow me on the Twitter machine at Ross on Wrestling. Joe Hendry.
Do you want my Twitter handle or just am I saying bye? Or
Twitter handle.
Okay.
That was a nice
Twitter handle. At Joe S. Hendry.
Follow Cultaholic everywhere at Cultaholic, apart from Instagram, which is We Are Cultaholic. If you like what we do here at Cultaholic, please head over to our Patreon page, patreon.com/cultaholic. There's tiered rewards, there's gifts, there's goodies, there's all sorts. Any sort of money you can afford to give us will be greatly appreciated and then retitivated back into many different things to continue to provide the lovely content that you enjoy so much. But most importantly of all, Joe, what are we going to do? Join us.
Oh, join us, yes.
Ha-ha, seamless.
Right. That's my heart.
Okay, thanks. Did you follow it?
That's creepy. I don't know.